Deeply embedded in man's search for enrichment stand the beckoning feet of the past we share. The fire for our dreams and the wings for our courage are woven on the anvil of relentless history. In early attempts at history, humans went in for art, maths, marketing, and leisure. A restless breakaway group went in for sport, religion, science, and work. This happened to be the winning combination, and they began winning in Europe. The Europeans began making empires out of Afro-Asian nutmeg and gold plate, and government was by divine right of kings. Because of the English Channel, England had more nutmeg ports than anyone else, and there sprang up along the bustling wharfside factories, Stirling, the C of E, and the middle class. This alarmed the Catholic aristocrats, who had land and the Pope, but were becoming a bit short on money, so they began using Parliament to do deals with the middle class. When the Cockneys found out, they developed a native wit and began stealing bread in defiance. It was decided to send these people to Australia till they learned to protest through proper channels. The intellectuals who were no good at science went in for philosophy. Some foreign philosophy had got into the wrong hands, and workers were talking about the pursuit of happiness. The governors, the New South Wales Corps, and the English felons began pursuing happiness in Australia. Became clear that the simple officers were becoming criminals, the criminals were becoming simple workers, and the governors were becoming depressed. Under William IV, England became steam-driven, which drove the Morris dancers into the cities and into such poverty that it could only be explained as a divine warning. And that was the making of the Church of England and a moralizing boom culminating in Queen Victoria. The Presbyterians, who found industrial evangelism unrewarding, went to Australia to reform the graziers' wives and set up a prosperous Australian morality that never looked back. The praying paid off at once, and it was noticed in the House of Lords that MacArthur's merinos were getting woollier than Border Leicester's, and the House rose in uproar. They decided to turn the convict settlement into a colony and make a quick profit. The idea of profit captured the restless Australian imagination. Governor Macquarie began trying to sell land before the squatters could squat it. Selectors moved in on the squatters. Everyone began putting up fences and knocking them down, branding, cheating, abusing, and bribing. When the British objected to the vulgarity, they moved the procedure into state parliament houses, thus achieving responsible government. Looking for land became a national pastime, not counting the Aborigines and their 3,000 years of culture. Explorers found nothing in the outback. Writing about nothing in the outback became the basis for Australian literature. Things were getting so lonely in the bush that mateship became popular. and its impact so swept the country, politicians gave everyone the vote and stopped taking converts. Just as the whole country was bogging down in a swamp of sermons and good manners, gold was discovered. This great find quickly brought swearing, greed, the Irish, vaudeville, destitution, and other signs of potential nationhood. Most of the diggers dug in the wrong places and had the Eureka stockade and drifted back to the cities. Alert politicians, seeing an idle workforce, set up banks and lent themselves money to start the great Australian secondary industries, with laws to keep out the Asians and tariffs to keep out the British. Queen Victoria and the Asians were not amused, but they had the Indian Mutiny on at the time. Failing to amuse the Queen alarmed the squatters, and there began the old dispute between the aristocracy and commerce. At the same time, America was having a civil war between the aristocracy and the rights of man. Industrial Europe moved on to the great debate between rich and poor. The rich had Darwin and the survival of the fittest, and the poor had Marx, and to everyone according to his need. Fired by great cricket winning, Australians became proud of their land. Unfortunately, more of them wanted to own it than work it, which caused a boom, a depression, a maritime strike, and a Labour Party. The sudden appearance of politics terrified the government, which began looking around for a foreign influence, and noticed that everyone had a navy except themselves and the Boers. So they began nationalism and federation. This allowed the states to concentrate on property and left federal government to romantic idealists. One of the romantic ideals then current was that the world's wealth belonged to its citizens, and they set up the Commonwealth Bank. This panicked everyone with property. Governments went in and out, and they eventually got a tariff board, arbitration, and white Australia. The panic was ended by the appearance of electricity. Australia was just about to close the national doors completely when the Serb shot the Austrian prince at a disastrous time for the Europeans, whose economies had become so dependent on appearances that rather than lose face in the Balkans, they had to have a great war all over Europe.
It's a long way to Tipperary, to the sweetest girl I know. Oh, goodbye, Piccadilly.
For Australians, the war confirmed their views on foreigners, so they sent their Prime Minister over to be insolent to the League of Nations. This victory, along with the war, was the making of federal government.
My name is zip, 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 you're surely lucky.
The main worry was the $28 billion everyone owed the United States. They tried to save money by not importing one another's exports, which caused a glut. The war-losing countries saw the glut as worker exploitation and went in for politics and anarchy. The war-winning countries saw the glut as potential prosperity and went in for jazz and peace talks. Australian banks spent the farmers' wool check getting the Bank of England's books balanced. So they ran out of money and closed their doors and started the Depression. Disillusioned people gave away mateship and began frightening one another with overseas politics. The Russians tried giving the wealth to the people and government to the ruling class. The Germans tried giving the wealth and the government to the ruling class and stability to the people. The West was giving government to the people and the wealth to the ruling class. Despite some tennis victories, some political debate began. But the situation was relieved when the United States went in for advertising. Australians took to swing, westerns, and getting into debt. The Europeans, tormented by the League of Nations, erotic ballet, Dada, Freud, and bad borders, began clamoring for positive steps. Weakened by political debate, they began making and breaking treaties at random and humiliated each other into the Second World War. Vera Lynn and Churchill got the British into queues, while bombs were dropped on their Wren architecture and on Frankfurt living rooms to decide who was right. And Australia sent dried fruits and the rats of Tobruk. As well as the current race hatreds, there was race insanity. The Japanese were still trying to equal China and wheeled and dealed around Southeast Asia and aroused the Americans who were at the movies at the time. America mobilized some warships strategically, and the Japanese sank them. Japan moved down to New Guinea, insolently liberating European colonies nobody had heard of. Oppenheimer put an Einstein theory into practice, and the boys were home for Christmas. The poor thought that the great victory against oppression would mean freedom from poverty and began striking in impatience. The rest thought that the great victory against oppression would mean freedom from government interference and voted in a symbolic government. The United Nations organization was set up to keep the 120 nations at peace when 70 of them discovered that they were still colonies. With some violence and celebration, they threw off the chains of colonialism and were strongly advised to turn their paddy fields into heavy industries through the proper channels. And the big powers had a demonstration Cold War. The Australian government tried to cover up with royal visits. But finally, 1,200 million Asians were discovered to the north. Believing the Asians had been caused by socialism, the Catholics began a purge on the unions, and accidentally split the Labour Party. This allowed the government to relax again and hand over control to the arbitration court, foreign capital, and television.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know. Everything about it is appealing.
The workers went middle class and got enough education to notice that the quality of television was better than the quality of life. Then they noticed Negroes and Aborigines, and parents noticed teenagers, and women noticed themselves. And soon, 3,000 million people began noticing one another. Then it began to show that the people with the best education were making some of the worst judgments.
For the times they are a-changin'. Of writers and critics who prophesize with your pen, and keep your eyes wide, a chance won't come in. And don't speak to the for the wheels still in spin, and there's no time.
With education in doubt, teachers who only had textbooks on winning and discipline became uncertain whether to go on. As a result, students began to go in for losing and turning the sound up. Art was attempted, but to no avail. The science, industrial, military, vaudeville, public service complex took over to restore order. This allowed people to give up politics and concentrate on obscenity, pollution, morals, and minerals. And with money automated, there was nothing to do but wait. And hopes remained high.